Oke, selamat pagi. Assalamualaikum kepada semua. Dato' Fairuz, Dato' Usnang, Dato' Masyita. Sekarang saya nak present berkenaan dengan drug poisoning lah. Basically ada empat lah saya nak present. PCM, salicylates, benzodiazepines dengan opioids. Okay, start dengan PCM dulu sebab dia paling common. So this slide is basically explain why PCM, how PCM become toxic lah. So actually PCM is when dia become toxic bila dia converted to toxic metabolite called as N-acetylbenzoquinamine, which is normally inhibited by conjunction with reduced glutathione. So when glutathione ni reduce ataupun depleted macam, so PCM will convert to this enzyme lah, N-acetylbenzoquinamine, so cause toxic. Usually after a large dose lah, after a large dose baru glutathione ni depleted and toxic metabolite will binds to the liver enzyme causing necrosis. And PCM, basically PCM ni memang selalunya toxic to the liver lah and causing the, can cause liver necrosis. So the liver necrosis can occur as little as 10 gram lah of doses, which is 20 tablets.
So based on information yang Abdullah cakap dalam slide ni, slide pertama ni, ada beza tak kalau patient tu dia patient yang makan say 20 gram PCM, seorang dia makan 20 gram in one go compared to seorang tu makan 20 gram dalam masa 48 jam.
Tak sama rasanya sebab dia dia punya duration tu depends pada satu, ada nomogram lah, nomogram table.
Tak, maksudnya kan sebagai Abdullah cerita pasal glutathione ni kan. So for patient yang ambil 20 gram in one go, most likely dia akan deplete lah glutathione ni and PCM tu can cause necrosis lah to hepatocellular cell kan. Tapi if patient tu ambil 20 gram dalam masa 48 jam, maksudnya dia mungkin ambil 1 gram pagi, 2 gram petang, 4 gram malam, then next day ambil sikit-sikit. This kind of patient may not necessarily overwhelm glutathione tu sebab glutathione tu sempat untuk regenerate.
Regenerate lah.
Okay. Patient yang consume large amount tapi over long period ni, kadang-kadang walaupun dia ambil banyak, they don't develop paracetamol toxicity because of this mechanism lah. If you give enough time for the glutathione to regenerate, you tak ada problem pun. The problem is when you take a large amount in one go. That's why you need to understand the mechanism of how paracetamol is metabolized in the body. Okay, tak apa.
Okay, faham. So, ini introduction lah. Okay, as everyone know lah, PCM ni the commonest drug that taken overdose locally, where single injection 7.5 gram is usually empirical threshold for possible toxicity. Maksudnya 7.5 gram ni macam apa, baseline lah, baseline untuk toxic. Lebih macam 15 tablet lah kalau 7.5 gram ni. So toxicity has been shown to occur with injection doses more than 150 mg/kg body weight ataupun dalam dos ialah 7.5 gram lah, 15 tablets in average size adult. Okay, however, toxicity can occur juga dekat lower dose in patient yang memang ada liver problem lah, hepatic enzyme induction. Example, patient yang taking anticonvulsant, anorexic patients who have pre-existing glutathione depletions. Okay, in such cases, use the high-risk treatment on the RUNET methylnomogram. this mammogram saya akan tunjuk later lah. So rather than normal treatment line, kalau patient yang memang tak ada underlying disease of liver, so management dia low risk lah berbanding patient memang ada underlying of liver disease. So the RUMET methyl mammogram ni actually useful lah to determine the need of NSC ataupun N-acetylcycline ataupun nama brand dia Provalex therapy following a single acute injection. So NSC ni usually almost 100% effective given 8 hours of injection. So dia macam apa, dia punya efektif tu kalau injection of PCM dia dalam within 8 hours lah, tapi within 4 hours lah toxic. Tapi kalau most effective during 8 hours lah based on the mammogram. So, however, it can be used up to 24 hours of injection if the history suggests of significant overdose, serum paracetamol is not available. Okay, guiding philosophy in managing paracetamol poisoning is if in doubt, treat in with NSC lah. Kalau kita macam in doubt lah, tak tahu dia actually toxic to PCN tu berapa hours, just bagi je NSC. So yang saya inform tadi berkenaan dengan RUMET methyl mammogram ni, so kat sini kita tengok kat tepi tu dia ada AP level, maksud dia amphetamine level. So yang bawah tu duration of injection lah. So kalau tengok the starting dekat 4 hours of injection, lepas tu 8 hours, 12 hours, 16 hours, 20 hours, or 24 hours. Within 4 hours tu dah kira toxic lah. But the most accurate time is 8 hours of injection lah. The 100% NSC tu kena be 100% atau apa, punya efektif. Sebab kan kalau tengok 4 hours tu, dia punya toxic level tu, acetaminophen level dia 200 lah. Kalau tengok line tu, kalau 8 hours, dia bukan at T smoking level, at T microgram per mil. But kalau makin ke depan, makin longer the duration of injection, toxicity dia actually semakin menurun lah. Okay. Sebab kita tengok line, solid line tu, bukan yang dot line tu lah. Dot line tu actually untuk high risk, solid line tu untuk low risk. At least I mean yang macam yang patient yang ada lain liver toxicity lah. So kalau NSC tu, kalau kita start, kalau within 4 hours tu kita dah boleh start lah NSC. But most accurate time during 8 hours. Yang tepi acetaminophen level yang tepi kiri tu, jadi kita tengok based on TDM level lah. Dia ada 2, 10, 20, 40, 80 lah. Hello.
Actually, with time progression tu, bukan dia punya toxicity reducing maksud jadual ni. Maksudnya kita perlukan level of acetaminophen tu dia lebih rendah lah dengan time. Maksudnya katakan 16 jam tu, kalau level dia dah 20, I mean dekat sini macam 20 lebih tu pun dia kira toxic lah sebab dah.
Okay.
Dia bukan kata semakin rendah dia punya toxicity.
Sorry. Dia lagi rendah level acetaminophen tu lagi toxic lah kalau duration time longer lah maksudnya. Sebab kalau lagi longer the time, dia higher toxicity lah. Sorry.
Lagi satu, perasan tak? Before 4 hours, dia warna hitam je.
So, actually, kalau
that's why EDM level ni should be taken before 4 hours.
Yes.
Tak boleh nak plot dekat graf Pakcik RUMET ni, Pakcik Matthew ni lah. Kalau you faham benda ni, then you understand why less than 4 hours tak perlu ambil TDM level.
Biasanya saya baca kalau less than 4 hours ni, sebab PCM kita ambil dia tak fully reabsorb lah. Dia perlu dia masa 4 hours, hours untuk reabsorb. So
be fully reabsorb to the body lah.
Sebab tu kita start dengan 4 hours. Okay. So dia ada empat phase lah untuk CM toxicity ni. Dia ada starting dengan phase 1 initial latent hepatic recovery up to 14 hours. So initial ni usually dia present dengan macam biasa lah, yang starting dia standard yang datang kat ED tu, nausea, vomiting. It might have present dengan rise in transaminase. Kita ambil LFT lah. So within 24 to 72 hours, which is latent phase, patient might have symptoms of signs of right upper quadrant pain, and the transaminase will be increasing in level, and it cause bilirubin also increase, and it affect the coag profile, which is the elevated NPT. NPT ni sebab liver juga produce prothrombin lah, dia punya mechanism tu. So phase 3 ni dia start lah nak necrosis. Necrosis mean dia effect habis lah liver, can have a sign of jaundice, and toxic can go to the brain lah. It can cause encephalopathy, coagulopathy, which is during PT time, can affect the renal also, and lastly can cause death. Phase 4, which is resolution, resolve of hepatic dysfunction and healing of liver damage. Kat bawah tu actually special tips for GP. Kalau patient yang ada PCN overdose ni, usually look well lah at initial stage. Except may present only nausea, vomiting. Kalau kita indoor, the accuracy of history, patient should be referred to ED lah for further evolution. Do not induce emesis. Okay.
So the aim of treatment dengan NAC apa semua ni adalah untuk prevent patient going to stage 3 lah. Sebab kalau kat stage 3 tu complicated by death, dia tak sampai lah phase 4. So dia habis kat phase 3 je lah. So the aim of our treatment dengan NAC apa semua ni is to prevent patient from going to phase 3 lah. Okay. So if we, so by the time kalau patient tu masuk phase 3, dia ada necrosis, jaundice apa semua, the treatment actually liver transplant lah. Dia tak banyak benda yang boleh buat lah. And how easy it is to get liver transplant in Malaysia? Houseman boleh order je ke? Tak boleh kan? So that's why the importance of the first 24 hours tu lah. Determining whether patient be overdose and to administer treatment lah to prevent patient going to stage 3.
So basically memang standard lah, kita patient datang kita kena resus dulu, check the airway, if patient macam nampak tachycardia can start oxygen, monitor SpO2, take ECG, and also monitor oximetry every 15 minutes at get the IV line, maybe we can start the NAC. NAC kena ada infusion lah, kena ada line. And gastric lavage ni present within an hour injection lah, tapi kita dekat ini kita tak advise gastric lavage. Notes kat bawah tu, the evidence does not supportive of gastric lavage unless the patient has ingested of toxic dose PCM. Gastric lavage ni kita bagi bila start, bila terlalu toxic lah, and presented within first hour.
Gastric lavage ni in general tak buat. So tapi dia kata kalau nak buat pun, if patient makan banyak sangat, then lepas makan tu terus main. Maksudnya within 1 hour lah. Kalau lepas makan tu tidur dulu, then no point buat gastric lavage. Tu je. So just keep it in mind lah, tapi it's not something that kita practice. Really very specific circumstances je. Okay, carry on.
So some authors suggest that the gastric lavage can be omitted lah kalau kita buat call.
Next slide.
Okay. Ni investigation kita buat macam biasa lah. I see crap sebab PCN can cause renal failure juga, liver function, LFT, PT time lah. And usually in PCN, dia punya level tu kita tengok dekat alanine transaminase, which is dekat LFT lah. Alanine transaminase can increase by more than 5,000 microunit per liter. Highly suggestive of hepatotoxicity due to PCM, since level of sodium seem in hepatitis lah. dia tak nampak dekat hepatitis, tapi PCM dia akan increase in alanine pasal minus ni. From evidence-based medicine standpoint, only serum PCM level is required to be drawn in PCM who show no sign of hepatotoxicity. Okay, this is mandatory lah, kita kena ambil serum PCM level. Then serum PCM level tu kita boleh decide lah, kita nak start NSC tak from the Ramek Matthew Mammogram yang tadi saya explain tu. So a more precise judgment is based on level taken for hours injection. It's not indicated earlier. So means that kita start NSC tu within 4 hours lah. Kalau less than 4 hours kita tak start lah, macam saya explain tadi tu. So serum PCM level ni kita kena ambil lah, mandatory. So other than that, activated charcoal, gastric lavage, macam saya present tadi, kita tak buat sangat lah, unless very toxic lah. NSC ni administer if within 4 hours lah. And based on mammogram tadi, initial serum level drawn earlier than 4 hours is already in toxic range. Kalau macam earlier than 4 hours, tak semestinya kita tak start NSC. Kita boleh start kalau patient tu nampak memang toxic lah, symptomatic. Kita boleh start walaupun dia tak sampai 4 hours. And the history sufficiently convincing significant overdose, which is more than 150 mg. Do not for the serum PCM level to return. Means that as I mentioned before, the yang kalau patient tu nampak memang symptomatic, nampak jaundice semua, within 4 hours tu, kalau tak sampai 4 hours kita boleh start lah NSC. And from the LFT test pun, kalau nampak deranged liver pun kita boleh start NSC juga. Sebab kita tak
nak sampai kalau patient tu dah jaundice apa semua, jangan start NSC. Sebab kalau patient dah jaundice apa semua tu dah 3 hari dah. So dah beyond the benefit of NSC tu. Kan, rasa tak kalau yang dah jaundice apa semua tu, patient dah phase 3 dah. Dah phase 3 tu dah ada hepatic necrosis apa semua tu, NSC would be fairly useless lah. Kalau you know, okay. Dia masa dia yang penting kalau nak start NAC without TDM level ni is memang patient bawa ni 20 papan saya makan PCM baru makan jam lepas, and patient symptom was mungkin vomiting je, tak ada lain pun, and the liver function might still be normal. Tapi kalau ada significant history, you know, more than 150 mg/kg, tak perlu tunggu PCM level lah. Should we start immediately lah NAC, or if TDM tak available kan, awak kat C ke kat Yan ke TDM take sehari nak balik kan, then tak boleh tunggu lah, kena start lah. Itu maksud dia. Tapi ingat lah, kalau patient kata saya dah makan PCM tapi dah jaundice juga, okay, itu sometimes takut dah too late lah.
Okay.
Eh, tambah sikit boleh?
Ini dos lah. Boleh. Saya
tambah sikit boleh? Pasal berkaitan dengan
okay.
Dengan dia punya level of acetaminophen tu, PCM level tu. Actually, yang kita kena tahu adalah dia punya NAC tu is effective if given within 8 hours from injection. Itu paling most effective lah. Tapi dia boleh bagi up till 24 hours from injection. So basically, kalau patient datang, okay. Datang 3 jam lepas dia makan. Okay. Maksudnya kurang dari 4 jam kan? So tunggu dulu sampai 4 jam. Baru ambil dia punya TDM level, ataupun katakan hospital kita tu tak boleh nak keluarkan TDM lebih daripada 8 jam daripada dia ingested tu. So yang tu kita boleh proceed terus bagi NAC. Kalau boleh tunggu katakan TDM tu siap dalam masa 1 jam, still masih within 8 hours tu, kita masih boleh tunggu untuk dapatkan result dan start NAC. Yang tu dia punya ni. Kemudian kalau katakan patient datang lebih daripada 4 jam tapi dalam 24 jam, yang tu masa tu kita boleh terus NAC kalau result tu kena. So yang kita kena tahu adalah NAC tu most effective is within 8 hours. So that after that kita boleh decide lah bila kita nak bagi untuk NAC tu. tu. Kita decide sendiri lah, tak payah nak depend on dia punya apa level tu lah. Okay, yang tu.
Faham? Okay. Okay, yang tadi NSC lah. Kalau kita tengok bawah tu, dia cerita macam mana infusion dia. Dia inji in 500 ml of 5% dextrose in 4 hours. Followed by continuous infusion 100 dpkg in 1 liter. 5% dextrose in over 16 hours. So, the total dosage kalau kita totalkan dia 20 hours lah. Which is 300 mg per kg. Kita nak bagi infusion dan reading boleh sampai 20 hours lah maksimum. So NSC dia ada side effect juga. Kita kena monitor lah dengan patient in NSC treatment. Patient might have present with nausea, flushing, urticaria, pruritus, okay, and also anaphylactic reaction lah. This happen to be both rate and dose related. Treatment kalau kita ada reaction, kita kena stop infusion for 15 minutes and start infusion at the slowest rate, which is 100 mg in 1 liter, 5% dextrose over 16 hours. So adjunctive treatment kita boleh bagi sekali lah antihistamik H1 antagonist untuk reverse back lah dia punya adverse effect, dia punya adverse effect of NSC ni. So patient with PCM toxicity ni dia ada poor prognostic lah following overdose. There are three, which are serum pH less than 7.3 that correct after resuscitation. Mortality is 52%. Normal pH but with PT prolonged more than 100 seconds and crack more than 3.4. Either grade 3 or liver grade 4 encephalopathy. The mortality rate is 81%. Serum pH less than 7.3 with uncorrectable with resus. The mortality is 90% lah. So PCM ni dia boleh can cause death lah. So kita kena actually kena prevent sampai stage 3 macam Dr. Faris cakap tadi. Okay, that's all about the PCM lah. Okay, kita start second drug is salicyclics. Salicyclics contoh drugs dia ialah aspirin lah. Pepto-Bismol dia content of salicyclic about 8.8 microgram per mil. Sports luminant ni macam kita apa minyak untuk sport lah, minyak untuk muscle and also wintergreen oil and also traditional Chinese medicine. So kita dah tanya history lah, patient tu ada ambil apa lah, contoh aspirin ke apa sebelum kita suspension. So dia punya artificial can cause toxicity tu, salicyclic ni actually dia akan stimulate the respiratory center producing hyper hyperapnea carbon dioxide kalau. So sebabkan respiratory colossi ni kidney try to compensate lah by excrete amount of bicarb chloride. So dia punya effect tu dia can cause later and dehydration based on dia punya compensation by the kidney. So other than that, dia juga interfere dengan carbon dioxide, carbohydrate metabolism and that lead to lactic acid acidosis, increase in ketone and also inorganic acid. Jadi the effect the lungs lah, lungs can cause hyper respiratory alkalosis and the renal compensate and lead to hypokalemia, dehydration and kalau more toxic lagi dia akan cause hyperkalemia. And other than that, there's called salicyclic ni juga can produce hypothermia juga. Salicyclic also cause liver injury lah, hepatocyte injury, resulting in increase in plasma enzyme and prolong PT time. Same as the PCM lah, dia can cause the liver damage. and also affect the platelet aggregation. So the early phase toxicity lah, dia ada mild, moderate, severe. Mild toxicity ni, the ingestion dia 150 to 200. Dia mostly dekat di lungs lah. Can cause hyperapnea dengan respiratory acrosis. Tak ada medullary respiratory center. Ada ledek, dia juga efek kat power ear lah. Auto-toxicity. Can present with tinnitus. Moderate ni, moderate toxicity ni 200 to 300. Present dengan vomiting. Starting to 3 to 6 hours ingestion. And then lead to metabolic acrolysis. Then more severe can cause hyperthermia, dehydration, abdominal pain, diaphoresis, which is the effect dia punya renal lah tadi as a compensatory mechanism. Kalau more severe lagi, dia, ingestion dia 300-400. This time dia effect dia punya CNS. Followed by depression and can lead to convulsion and coma lah. And other than that, can cause non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, arrhythmia, hemorrhage. Hemorrhage ni sebab liver tadi. Prolonged PT time, acute renal failure lah. Metabolic diagnosis. And also, can cause death juga sebab can collapse tadi. Cardiovascular collapse, respiratory failure and CNS system failure lah. Basically, the effect lungs, CNS, cardiovascular and also renal. Serum estimation lah. First estimation dia punya toxicity ni, the first level should be drawn approximately 2 hours ingestion and with repeat 6 hours. Kita ambil dia punya serum tu within 2 hours then repeat at 6 hours. Subsequently kita buat serial lah, serial every 3 to 4 hours, monitor dia punya level of serum. Should be declined by 10% from the preceding laboratory estimation tu. Okay. Significant toxicity can develop very rapidly, acute overdose, even before 6 hours. Salicylic level less than 30%, less than 6% does not rule out impending toxicity walaupun kita ambil kurang atau pun within less than 6 hours, kita tak boleh overestimate lah. Toxicity can happen juga walaupun dia dosis dia rendah. So, investigation macam saya explain tadi lah, kita ambil serum salicylates level more than 70 mg is toxic lah, can be moderate to severe. Level than 100 is very serious, can cause death. Other than that, from blood investigation can see that there is increase in hematocrit, white blood cell, platelet count, hyponatremia, hyper-K, hypo-K, hypoglycemia lah. So kena correct lah semua electrolyte imbalance ni. So respiratory acrolysis can present with metabolic acidosis jugalah. PT may be prolonged. Cari respiratory acrolysis ni kita kena start oksigen lah kalau patient ni asap kidney. Protonic time may be prolonged, kita kena assess patient if I have bleeding tendency or not. Okay, so management, as I mentioned, salicylates ni mainly the effect, early state they affect the lungs. So kita kena be aware lah, kita kena start oxygen in case is patient yang tak kidney, take ABG lah. Bagi start with IV line lah in case kita nak correct the electrolyte imbalance such as hyponatremia, hypo-K ke apa, and also hyper-K. Plastic lavage ni can be performed 10 to 4 hours. And also activated charcoal. But kita tak practice now. So dehydration tadi yang hypernatremia and acrosis ni kita boleh correct dengan 0.9% sodium normal saline dan potassium. Correct electrolyte imbalance, oxygen, glucose may be needed lah. So kalau patient yang tadi PT time tu hypoprotrombinemia ni prevent bleeding, kita boleh start dengan vitamin K. Either bagi IM ataupun IV. So acidosis will back up if severe. Less than 7.5 kalau patient dia on metabolic acidosis, kita boleh bagi sodium back up lah. So salicylate ni actually kita tak ada antidote lah. So other than that, management kita boleh buat urine alkalinization lah. Tak sure lah, boleh kita kita practice ke tak. Urine alkalinization ni maksudnya patient yang ada cyclic ni dia memang acid. So kita kena buat urine kita tu kena dalam bentuk alkaline lah. Alkaline, so kita neutralize dia sali cyclic tu. Bila neutralize baru sali cyclic tu boleh excrete through urine. Itu maksud dia. Hemodialysis ni bila dia ada indication lah untuk hemodialysis.
Bila apa dia? Urine alkalinization
nak buat macam mana? Urine alkalinization
pakai apa sebenarnya?
Ha? Pakai apa? Pakai apa? Saya tak sure tu.
Tak sure.
Tak sure.
Urine alkalinization ni yang pakai sodium
bicarb.
Kan just now
awak
mention dalam slide tu.
Oh, sodium bicarb. Apa tu?
Ha. Sodium bicarb kan alkaline kan? Ha. Okay. Gunakan sodium bicarb infusion lah untuk urine alkalinization tu. Banyak mana kita nak bagi, depend on pH. Maksudnya kita bagi serial sodium bicarb tu and monitor by using pH punya pH urine lah. Okay, continue.
Okay, faham. So kalau last stage tu hemodialysis ni bila sangat toksik lah. Bila overdose sampai more than 300 serum salicylic acid ni more than 300 after even after acute injection, refractory acidosis, liver cardiac toxicity, renal failure, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, neurologic signs such as psychosis, confusion, convulsion, rising serum salicylic acid level despite urine alkalinization and multi-dose activated charcoal therapy. So dari sini lagi efektif lah kalau macam terlalu toksik, kita direct dia kita buang terus melalui urine guna hemodialysis lebih cepat lah. So disposition for severe toxicity patient or those patient with rising serum salicylate obtain general medicine consultation in anticipation of admission to the high dependency of intensive care unit. Case of patient be managed by admission to general ward. Usually kita kena admit lah patient kalau untuk solid ni sebab dia effect lungs kan. Patient can have the kidney semua. So third drug is benzodiazepine. Benzodiazepine poisoning is usually causing death is rare lah unless other contentioning agents such as alcohol has also been taken. So dia punya patofisio ni dia actually inhibit GABA on the CNS. Other examples of benzodiazepines are there are three class of drugs lah, long acting, short acting, ultra short acting. Long acting ni contoh diazepam lah most common, and short acting ni macam alprolam, lorazepam, ozepam. Ultra short acting ni most common is midazolam. Other than that is temazepam and triazolam. So benzodiazepine for pathophysiology ni actually they affect the spine lah for CNS. Generally they can cause generalized depression of spinal reflex as well as inhibit the reticular activating system that finally resulting in lethargy, slurred speech, ataxia, hyporeflexia, drowsiness, stupor, coma and also respiratory arrest. And patient dengan with benzodiazepine kena check pupils dah sebab di patient might when patient with a dose the pupil non specific but generally not pinpoint lah impure opioid overdose. So other than that they can cause hypotension and cardiopulmonary arrest after rapid IV injection of diazepam. The half-life of benzodiazepine vary widely from 2 to 5 hours. Half-life untuk midazolam 2 to 5 hours. Kalau chlorazepam oxide, 5 to 30 hours. Kalau flurazepam ni, half-life dia 50 to 100. Okay, clinical features, as I mentioned, ni dia affect the spine lah. Spine, so CNS. So the patient may present with weakness, ataxia, dysarthria, dysthymus, drowsiness, confusion, and also paradoxical excitation. Confirmation of diagnosis is made by obtaining serum level. So kita kena ambil serum benzodiazepine lah. Supportive management, macam kita resuscitate patient first lah, as usual lah, kita bagi airway kalau patient yang tak kidney. Start oxygen, take blood, baseline, ABG. Serum benzodiazepine ni actually not necessary during acute management, but of overdose, but qualitative urine or blood screen method, if available, can be performed in case of diagnosis in dog. Okay, serum benzodiazepine kita boleh buat tu bila diagnosis in dog je actually. Not necessarily during acute management. Okay, administer activated charcoal if the time ingestion within 4 hours and also gastric lavage lah. However, kita kena airway must be protected first lah before kita start other management lah. For antidote untuk benzodiazepine ini we call as flumazenil, which is actually a competitive benzodiazepine receptor antagonist. They can it can reverse CNS and respiratory depression and can prevent the need of endotracheal intubation. So dosage tu kita bagi 200 microgram IV over 15 hours. If needed, further doses can be
15 seconds. Hello? 200 microgram IV 15. Over 15 seconds, bukan 15 hours. Itu dah jadi infusion dah.
Sorry. 15 seconds. Okay. Further doses, kita bagi 100 microgram given at 1 minute intervals up to total doses of 1 to 2 mg. Bila tu respons ni, bila dah tak respons ni, not suggestive of benzodiazepine poisoning lah.
Maksudnya, so, kalau dah bagi sampai 2 mg, untuk,
pulmonizing ni sensitif untuk
benzo lah.
Okay. So, recurrence untuk, bagi.
Tak. Teruskan.
Okay. Okay, recurrence tu nak jadi balik lepas antidot lagi tinggi sebab dia short duration lah, flumazenil ni short duration. So kita kena repeat balik dia punya antidot tu above regime by continuous effusion 0.1 to 0.
Dia bukan saja repeat balik, maksudnya lepas korang bagi flumazenil, lepas tu patient bangun, jangan happy dan tinggal pergi main telefon. Kena tengok-tengok balik patient lah sebab dia short acting, habis flumazenil tu dia akan tidur balik. Dia maksudnya kalau patient tu respiratory depression sampai D-set dan sebagainya sebab benzo punya poisoning, korang bagi flumazenil, korang tengok patient bangun, korang happy lah, sambung main telefon kan. Jangan buat macam tu sebab flumazenil ni short acting, takut masa korang duduk main telefon dia punya respiratory depress balik. So they need to be closely monitored. Itu maksud dia.
Okay. So bila ada recurrence balik macam tu tadi tu, kita boleh bagi 0.1 to 0.5 mg per hour. Adjusted according to the level of arousal. So this position, patient with benzodiazepine, most of all of them should be admitted. To general if necessary to high dependency intensive care unit if ventilatory support if required.
Okay,
so last okay.
Flumazenil.
Apa
caution bila kita nak bagi flumazenil kat patient?
Caution.
Apakah keburukan flumazenil? Oh, you know, duk cerita benda baik kan, dia reverse benzo dan sebagainya. Apa benda yang potensial boleh berlaku dengan TikTok yang keluar? apa potential problem yang boleh berlaku bila you bagi flumazenil kat patient? Ni kena beware bila takut sekali-sekali berlaku, korang terkejut pula.
reverse NS and can reverse it. Dia ni ada hyperventilate.
Hyperventilate. Benzo ni biasa korang bagi untuk patient yang datang sebab apa? Benzodiazepine. Kalau MID ni patient apa yang biasa korang bagi benzodiazepine selain pada sedation?
Patient yang PSY macam
bukan yang bukan untuk sedation. Maksudnya PSY tu pun agresif korang nak sedate juga. Selain pada sedation, apa lagi situation yang commonly korang bagi benzodiazepine? Common ni, almost every day, 3 kali sehari saya rasa. Kawan-kawan boleh tolong. Kawan-kawan yang 3-3 orang ni. Dia ratio houseman dengan specialist 1-1. Apa dia?
Common lagi.
Jawapan dia adalah seizure lah. Patient datang fit kan.
Korang
bagi benzodiazepine. So one of the things that you need to be careful when it comes to flumazenil ni. Flumazenil can induce seizure.
Okay.
Memanglah niat korang nak reverse benzo tu. Tapi flumazenil itself can induce seizure. Especially in patient yang chronically abuse benzo. If you bagi flumazenil, you may induce a sudden withdrawal punya episode lah, and patient may develop seizure. So tujuan bagi tahu ni bukan kata jangan bagi flumazenil. Tujuan nak bagi tahu ni, nak bagi tu kena ada indication. Maksudnya if the airway is compromised, patient is apnea dan sebagainya. Yang kedua, kalau bagi patient develop seizure, janganlah terkejut sangat. We keep calm. Jalan.
Okay. My last topic is opioids. So common agent heroin, morphine, methadone, meperidine. Codeine. Symptoms of opioid ni, a triad of coma, pinpoint pupils and depressions. So it also can present with hypotension, bradycardia, hypothermia, convulsion, cardiac arrhythmia, renal failure and pulmonary edema. Pupils may be dilated and acidosis or hypoxia. So mainly the effect yang tadi lah, the effect dia punya pulmonary and can cause hypoxia juga. So management tu kita bio test kat giving oxygen lah. Giving oxygen in patient ada coma or seizure, kita kena treat. In hypotension boleh bagi fluid resus. So naloxone is actually a pure opioid antagonist lah. Dia macam dia actually bukan antidot salah satu saja, tapi dia antagonist lah, antagonist untuk opioid ni.
Okay.
Useful in all cases suspected of opioid overdose lah. And also useful when opioid used together with alcohol or CNS system depressant. So yang naloxone ni kita bagi untuk reverse effect of the opioid ni, dosis dia kita bagi through IV lah. Dosis dia 0.4 to 1.2 mg, repeated at interval of 3 to 5 minutes to achieve a respiratory rate about 15 minutes or maximum of 10 mg. If respiratory function does not improve, then the question is question diagnosis lah. Ada mode of injection tu kita bagi subcutaneous or IM lah, other than IV, if IV not available. So naloxone duration of action is shorter than most of opioid, therefore repeated injection necessary. So as I mentioned, macam tadi, tu dia punya action tu short acting lah. So kita mungkin kena bagi lagi. Ultimately, it may be given by continuous IV infusion.
2 mg diluted in 500 of 5% dextrose or normal saline starting of rate of 100 ml per hour adjusted to according to response lah. So mainly analysis ni kita kena target untuk achieve dia punya respiratory rate tu within normal range lah, tak mau patient sakit ni. So kalau nak losan dia punya side effect tu, kita kena watch out lah signs of over treatment, sebab kita losan ni dia cause, dia bantu untuk respiration, so it can cause hyperventilation lah. Other than that, it can cause muscle tremor, tachycardia and hypertension. So otherwise kalau kita acute withdrawal symptom ni, tiba-tiba kita stop naloxone ni, dia can have acute withdrawal lah. Can have abdominal pain, sweating, dilated pupils, diarrhea, tremor and pyloric reaction. May develop chronic narcotic abuser and careful titration of the naloxone doses may be prevented. So kita kena monitor patient when kita stop the naloxone ni. If the appeal has been taken orally, gastric emptying may be valued up to 12 hours because of appeal induced delay in gastric infection. Actually, the appeal ni kalau kita ingest pun, dia punya effect tu lambat lah. Within 12 hours pun baru-baru nak effect. So, gastric emptying ni boleh buat jugalah tapi kita tak practice. Sebab dia, appeal ni dia punya action tu lama lah. Nak lambat 12 hours, within 12 hours. Other than that, kita bagi intermittent positive pressure ventilation may be required if patient have pulmonary edema. Jangan kita tak boleh bagi diuretic dekat patient opioid ni, sebab patient dengan with opioid ni can cause leakage of pulmonary capillaries, not too fluid overload lah.
Intermittent positive pressure ventilation ni apa benda aku?
Intermittent positive pressure lah.
Ventilation ni.
Oksigen. Oksigen.
Kawan-kawan, ada Chelsea, Spiky dan Ambar Asif. IPPV ni apa?
Ambar Asif boleh. Ha? Masih. Dia ada baca tadi.
Ha. Asif ha. Asif ada ke? IPPV ni apa? IPPV ni adalah nama lain kepada intubation lah. Intubation dan ventilation.
Okay.
Janganlah terkejut sangat. Dia pakai terma IPPV. Yeah. It's just intubation and ventilation lah. So technically, it's basically any form of positive pressure ventilation lah. Actually, NIV pun consider part of IPPV lah. So basically dia cakap, kalau patient tu dah pulmonary edema, pakailah CPAP ke ataupun kena intubate lah. Tu je. So jangan bagi diuretic because dia bukan overload punya state. Dia because kadang-kadang lepas korang bagi naloxone, BP dia suddenly shoots up and menyebabkan pulmonary edema lah. So dan because dia juga because of leakage from pulmonary capillaries dan sebagainya, dia bukan overload per se. It's just patient mula-mula respiratory depressed, below, dan suddenly korang reverse up and dapat pulmonary edema lah. That's why bagi IPPV dulu rather than diuretics. Okay? Carry on.
Okay.
Banyak sekali lagi?
Habis dah. Okay. So, reference saya daripada Chili Oil dengan Sarawak Agency.
Okay, excellent. Ada soalan lain untuk Abdullah? Tak ada takut lah. Semua sudah kepenatan lah, mentally exhausted lah saya pun. Dua tu maksimum. Okay, anyway, thank you Abdullah. Thank you Chai Ying dengan thank you Jaya. Okay.
Thank you Dr. Boris. Okay. Bye.